Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Our Lord is good. You're all welcome tonight to our Bible study. And our topic tonight is speak the word only. And we believe that as we fellowship together tonight, even online, and you are listening to us from your various home, we believe that the power of God will touch you tonight and your life will never remain the same. You know, Jesus always gathered the disciples and teach them the word of God. One thing about preaching is that we get inspired. And people get excited, and before you know it, you know, they don't even know what the preaching says anymore. But teaching, you know, is impactful. So we believe in God tonight that as we go into His Word, you'll be imparted in the name of Jesus Christ. And that what you are going to be getting from this teaching, you are going to be able to use it in your life, you know. And, you know, this teaching is very important because you are what you say. So we are going to be, you know, going deep into His Word. And on Sunday, we are not able to really finish the what God has for us because God wanted to cancel our debt. So but tonight, we are believing that we'll be able to go into the Word, and we'll believe our life will never remain the same. So Father, we thank you tonight, and we give you all the glory. And even as we gather at your feet tonight, Holy Spirit, you are the great teacher. Say, in all our way, we should acknowledge you and you will direct our path. Holy Spirit, direct us tonight. Teach and impart us with your word. And at the end of everything, we promise to give you the glory. Thank you, Father, for in Jesus' name we are prayed. So before we go into the word, we are going to call on our choir. Hallelujah, the beautiful voices to take us into the awesome presence of God. Hallelujah. Choir, please take it from here.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the living Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. My soul, and all that is within me, bless His holiness. Bless the Lord. Yes, 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 yes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Bless His holy name. is the greatest, and he is holy name. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, 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 yes. This is the day the Lord has made. Joyful he has made me glad. I will enter his gate, has given him my heart. Enter his court with prayer. I will say, he has made me glad and so glad. He has made me glad, glad and rejoice, for he has made me glad. Thank you so much, Sister Praise. More grace in Jesus' mighty name. Praise the Lord once again. You are all welcome. And like I said, Jesus always do teaching with the people who gather, and we're teaching them because teaching brings knowledge. So I believe that Somebody's eyes of understanding will be open tonight as we go into this teaching. So I'll be taking it. I'm not going to rush because I really need you to get this understanding. So we're talking on the topic, speak the word only, but we're going to zero in on our confession, because you are what you say. You become what you say. Your confession is very important. Hallelujah. Where you are today is as a result of what you said yesterday. So now, if you don't like what is happening in your life now, it's time for you to switch, you know, make a switch and start saying what the Word of God says. And you can never go wrong saying what God says. Sometimes some people say, I just want to say it as it is. No, you're wrong. Because the book of Joel 3:10 says, let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. So now you can never go wrong saying what God says. And you can never lie when you say the word of God, because God can never lie. He said, let the weak say, I am strong. You know, we have been taught in this world, he said, don't say you are strong until you are strong. No. That's the way of this world. But, you know, our God, the God we serve, always calleth those things that be not as if they are. So we are made in his image. You know, we are made in his likeness. You know, the Bible says that when God made us, he made us in his image. He created us from the ground, and then he breathed on us, and then man became a living spirit. So now God is spirit. So when he breathed on us the breath of life, we became, the Hebrew Bible says, we became a living spirit. So we have to speak like God. So you cannot go wrong talking, you know, or speaking the word of God. That's why I want to go to Romans 10. Let's go to Romans 10. And we're looking from verse 8 to 11. Romans 10, 8 to 11. Please follow me as I follow the Holy Spirit. Now, what does the Bible say? Romans 10 from verse 8. We're reading from verse 8. But what said it? What said it? The word is near thee. The word of God is near thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. So now, the word of God must be in your mouth and in your heart. The word of God cannot be in your head. The word of God must be in your spirit, and which your heart is the spirit. That's where God dwells. Amen. Now, it says, but what said he? You know, the word is near thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith. So what word are we talking about? The word of faith, not the word of fear. The word of faith. You got to understand that. The word of faith. So believer, we don't speak fear. We speak the word of faith. Hallelujah. We call those things that be not as if they are. We speak the word of faith, not fear, because fear brings torment. Fear brings people in captivity. So we speak the word of what? Faith. Like when God saw darkness, he said, let there be light. And he expected light to show up. So we don't speak our challenges. We speak the word of God over our challenges. The same way we don't, you know, we don't pray the problem. We don't talk about the problem. We talk about our desire, what we want to see in the problem. Hallelujah. Now, somebody, so when you are praying about, oh, maybe you are sick, you don't be, you know, don't be talking about the sickness, talking about being well. Talk that you are well. My body is strong. My body is well. Everything in my body is functioning right. Don't be talking about weakness, because you don't want weakness. You want strength. So what you do in prayer, you speak faith. Praise the name of the Lord. Now, number 9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth. So now, you confess with your mouth, you know, with thy mouth that the Lord Jesus, confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and shall believe in thy heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. So now, you have to confess. This is not just think it. You know, if you think you are saved and you don't confess it, that means you are not saved. Now, people talk about positive thinking. You know, it's good to be positive. You think positive, but positive thinking is good, but it's not enough to save you from your problem. Because now, if somebody is sinking and is thinking positive, you are thinking positive, oh God, God is, you know, you are thinking, you're not saying anything, you continue to sink. Hallelujah. So now you have to open your mouth, because when you open your mouth, that's when you activate God. You activate the Holy Ghost to be able to bring you out and bring you out of that horrible or whatever situation you find yourself. So you don't think it, you have to what? Confess with your mouth. Now number 10 is now say, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth. So we make confession with our mouth. It's confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture said, whosoever believeth on him shall not be put to shame. So we need to establish the fact that if we believe God, we should not see shame in our life. And how do we eliminate shame in our life? We must be able to align ourselves with what God says. Because oftentimes, many people, we have not made a connection between what we say and what is obtained in our life. There's a correlation between it. What you say and what you are seeing in your life align. So as a man thinking, so he. So if you don't like what you are seeing now, you change your mouth. Praise the name of the Lord. God didn't talk about darkness. He said, let there be light. And that was what he saw. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Now let's look at Proverbs 18:21. What does it say? Let all of us go there. We're in Bible study. Proverbs 18. And we're going to verse 21. Now watch this. This is crucial. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. He didn't say death and life. This is crucial. You know, death and life. The Bible did not say death and life is in the power of Satan. You know, so you what happened in your life, you can put devil under your feet with your mouth. You can put the devil, you know, you can regulate things around you. You become untouchable when you know how to use your mouth. David used his mouth and he flattened Goliath. He brought him down. Hallelujah. So now the death and life are in the power of your tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. So now, what you say, you can either speak life or speak death. You can either, you know, death like poverty, sickness, you know, toiling and all that. You know, Peter was used to talking about toiling. So everything he was getting in his life, every day he goes to work, you know, was toiling because of what he was saying. He was getting, you know, I believe Peter would say, I'm going again today. I don't think I'll catch any fish. And he returned like that because as a man thinketh, so he is. Don't let your challenge take over your mouth, but let your mouth take over. Say amen to that, somebody. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Now, this word of God that we are talking about, I want us to go to Matthew 12. Matthew 12, so we can get better understanding of this thing. Matthew chapter 12. And we're looking at verse 33. You watch this now. 33. Thank you, Jesus. Now, listen to this. He said, either make the tree good and the fruit and its fruit good, or else make the tree corrupt and its fruit what? Corrupt. For the tree is known of his what? Of his fruits. The fruit of your leaf must be things that align with God. Amen. O generation of viper, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. Now, what's that word? Out of the abundance of the heart. So now, what, you know, your heart, like I was saying on Sunday, is like a bag that collects, you know, words. Amen. So now, what are the words that you have stored in your life? That's what the Bible said to Joshua. Meditate on the word of God. Let the word of God fill your life morning, afternoon, and night. So that's what you are meditating on. You don't meditate on anything that is not true. The only thing that God allows you to meditate is say whatever is the truth, whatever is of good report. That's what you should think about. And the Bible is the good report. So the Bible says you should think about this thing morning, afternoon, and night. Let him occupy your life. Give no room to this to Satan. So now when challenges come, because as a man thinketh, so he, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. So when challenges come and you are loaded with the word of God, what comes out of your mouth is the word of God. God is the word. So when challenges came, you know, like in my country, God did not say, yay, Egbami. God did not say that. He saw darkness. The word has no form. It was, I mean, what he was expecting was not what he got. He didn't cry, say, oh, devil, Satan again. No. What was him? It was the word. Let there be light. And that light was not the sunlight. He was just saying, let the glory appear. Hallelujah. And when glory comes, a man will rise. Darkness will be rolled away. So what did God do? He used the word of God, and God is the word, to roll away darkness. So you can do the same thing. You don't have to be alarmed with challenges. You don't have to cry in your challenges. You just speak the word of God. Hallelujah. But if you don't have the word of God, what can you give on the day of challenge? You just speak what the devil has shot into you. God forbid, in Jesus' mighty name. Now, let's keep reading. A good man out of the treasure of his heart bringeth forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart of treasure bringeth forth what? Evil things. But I say unto you that every idle word. Now this is crucial. But I say unto you, what? Pay attention to this. I say unto you that every idle word that man shall speak, they shall give account thereof on the day of judgment. And I won't let you know judgment start from here. Because if you read further, I say, for by thy word thou shalt be justified. What does it mean to be justified? To be set free. To live in liberty, to live in freedom live on top of poverty, sickness, and disease. Amen? So now what, and then by your word also, thou shalt be condemned. That means you'll be trapped by your word. You can be trapped in poverty. You can be trapped in shame. You can be trapped in lack. That will never be your portion. So what you say determine your lot in life. So how crucial is what we say? You shall have whatsoever you say. That's what the Bible says. So now, you need to change the way some of us, our word doesn't even have weight or value. That's what I'm trying to do as your pastor this day, this time, that every word that does not have weight, every word that is idle, that God will remove it in your life. And from this time, you begin to speak word. Because if you can fix your word, if you can fix your word, your mouth, you know, how do I put this? If you can fix your confession, you can make, okay, let me put it this way. If you can make your confession align with the word of God, if your confession align, you will get out of that trouble. You will come out of your challenges. If your mouth can align with the word of God, you can fix your mouth. You will come out of that trouble. Because it says, by your mouth, you shall be what? Justified. By your mouth, you shall be condemned. That means our mouth plays a lot of role in our life. Amen. And how do we make sure that we speak the right word? By reading the word of God. Let the word of God dwell in you richly. You can't be lazy with the word of God. Amen. Now, let's go to Isaiah 55 verse 11. Isaiah 55 verse 11. Amen. You know, the law of gravity is predictable. The same way, The law of confession that we are dealing with tonight is also predictable. How do I know? That's why I want to read this scripture to you. Isaiah 55. Let's go there quickly. Please pay attention. You'll be blessed. Isaiah 55. Thank you, Jesus. I say thank you, Jesus. Isaiah 55. We are going to be going to verse 11. Isaiah 55, verse 11. Please go with me there. Thank you, Jesus. Now, maybe we should read from number 10. For as the rain cometh down and the snow from heaven, and returneth not tighter, but watereth the heart, and maketh it to bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. Now, number 11. So shall my word be that goeth out of my mouth. Amen. That goeth out of my mouth, it shall not return void. So the word does not return void, but it shall accomplish. So every word of God that we speak always accomplish that which the Lord pleases, and it shall prosper in that whereunto I sent it. So anytime we speak the word of God, it must prosper. That means God is saying, because God is the word. If you look at John 1, in the beginning was the word, and the word was God, and God was the word. He's saying that my word is predictable. When I say it, it must produce harvest. So that means as a child of God, when we pray or we speak the word, we must expect that what we say will come to pass. Now, watch this now. Let's look at this in Amplified Bible. And we're going to look at it because we are doing Bible study. We're digging deep. Let's look at it in Amplified, and then let's look at it in Message Bible. Go to Amplified now of the same scripture. Thank you, Jesus. Amplified Bible, number 11. So will my word be which goeth out of my mouth. It will not return to me void. That means, now look at it. He said, that means the word of God will not be useless. It will not be without result. That means, I want you to understand, the word of God is not just anything. The word that we speak, their spirit and their life. It's, the word of God is not just sound. It's not noise. It said, the word of God, it will not return to me void. It will not be useless or without result. That means you need to establish that the word of God always produces results. The word of God will produce results. That's why he said, if you believe the word of God, you will never be put to shame. Scripture says, if you believe it, you will not be put to shame. That's Romans 10, 11. You will not be put to shame because the word will produce results. And I'm speaking right now because while Jesus was teaching, the power of God was available. What is the power of God? The Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is waiting on my word. Hallelujah. Even as angels are waiting on your word, the same way angels are waiting on your word, devil is after your tongue. He's waiting. Hallelujah. He's waiting for your word because when you say it, he knows that he can get it done in your life. He will bring that into pass. But the only way to resist the devil is never to say the problem, but speak the word of God over the problem. That's what the Bible now said in Joel 3:10. Let the weak say. The weak should not say, I'm weak. Because if you say you are weak, devil will make you weak. Because that's what he's doing. Devil go the opposite of God. So God said, don't say you are weak. Say you are strong. As long as you say you are strong, it's just like saying, let there be light. And there was light. So as long as you say you are strong, you'll just find that the Spirit of God will just bring that strength, and all of a sudden you find that the sickness is not there no more. Hallelujah. Now Paul was talking, he said, the things which you have taught, the things we have handled, I'm not preaching to you. So if you begin to say you are well, you just find that out of everything in your body systems are working right. But once you begin to say you are weak, you want people to pity you. Hey, as children of God, we are as bold as lions. We don't need nobody to pity us. We are the world. We are the light. We don't need no one. We are light. We are salt. We must not lose our light. We must not lose our saltness. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. So now we are able to establish that the word of God will produce what? Result. So as you are listening to me right now, if your life is without result and you are listening to the word of God now, from this moment, you'll begin to see results in Jesus' mighty name. Now, without accomplishing what I desire. So now the word of God, we accomplish what God desires. Now, the word of God says, by his stripes you are healed. Now, that word must accomplish what God desires. What God desires is that you overcome that sickness. By his stripes you are what? Healed. So now, the word of God must accomplish. That's what God is expecting. So that's why the Bible now says, can two walk together except they agree? So God is looking for a child of God that will agree with him. And they will speak the same language. It's difficult for people to walk with you if they don't speak the same language. As a child of God, it's wisdom for you to understand you have to speak the same language with God. Now, if you have a subordinate, you're a manager, and somebody is working as your assistant, the person must not go opposite side. If he goes opposite way to you, no work is get done. And eventually, somebody will be fired. So now you got to walk with God. You got to agree with God. How do you agree with God? You say what God says. Sometimes it might look like you are lying. You're not lying by speaking the word of God. You say, let the weak say, I am what? Strong. And as you say that word will accomplish what God wanted, what God desired, or what God sent the word to do, it will do in your life. Now watch this now. And without succeeding in the matter for which I sent it. That means, it said, the word will succeed in the matter for which I send it. So whatever that matter, no, a woman was going through a challenge. The matter that she was going through was the woman with the issue of blood. And the Bible said, by the stripe, you know, you are healed. So the woman said, if I can touch the hem of his garment, if I touch the word of God, because there's virtue in the word, hallelujah, if I touch the word, I will be made whole. Amen. She believed it. And as soon as she touched it, she was what? Made whole. Because the word we always produce at any time. He said, and without succeed, the word will succeed in the matter which I sent it. That's why the Bible says he sent his word healed. That's why the centurion in Matthew 8:8. I hope you are following it. He said, you don't need to come to my send my word. The man have understanding that the word of God is predictable. He said, if I tell one of my soldier, give me 10 push-ups, he must do it. He must not say no. So he expects, he said, if I tell them come, I ask them go, I expect him not to ask me any question, but go. But the question is that most of us, we question the word of God. Why do you have to question the word of God? Just do whatever he tells you to do, just do it. If God says you are well, just keep saying I'm well. If God says you are rich, keep saying you are rich. Amen. He said it will succeed in the matter which I sent it. Now let's go to Message Bible. The word of God will succeed in my life. What about you? The word of God will succeed in your life. He said, this word is not ordinary, though. It's not a sound. It's not a cliche. This word of God will succeed. That's why you instead of making all this idle word, your leg is killing you, you're dying to go, your back is killing you, somebody asks how you are doing, you say you are surviving. Say you're blessed. Hallelujah. I have more than enough. Thank you, Jesus. Now let's go to Message Bible now. Message Bible. We're looking at the same scripture. I need that in the Message Bible. Just give me 1 second. All right, got it. Now, Isaiah 55, we're going to Message Bible, verse 11. Watch this now. Okay, where do I take this from? Okay. In the Message Bible. Just 1 second. All right, so the word that comes out of my mouth. Aha! So will the word that comes out of my mouth not come back empty and dead? The word of God will not return empty handed. They will do the work I sent them to do. Say amen to that, somebody. The word we do, then this is God talking. Can God lie? It's impossible for God to lie. He said, the word we do the work. So the word of God always do a work. Write it down. Amen. The word of God will do a work in your life in Jesus' mighty name. The word of God will give you a better hand in this year. Amen. That's what the word of God, it does a work. I send them to do. They will complete. Aha, watch this now. This is good. This, I love the woo! I love the word of God. He said, they will complete the assignment I gave them. So the word of God is not just a cliche or ordinary paper. It's a spirit. Amen. They are life. Just like you have life, the word, the paper, the Bible you already has life. You have to see it that way. He said, they will complete the assignment I gave them. So every scripture is an assignment. Hallelujah. And then once you begin to confess it, hallelujah, they must not come back void. That's why as a pastor, if I pray to you, if I pray over you, God says, if his son will speak his word over you, he said, he will bring that cancer to pass. That's why those that know God, they don't play with the word of God. He said, they will complete the assignment I gave them. Now, listen, church. God gave us a word. He said, 2020, that's the word he gave us. That word is a flood of blessings on assignment. Yes. It's on assignment. So, as a church, we're going to see blessing all over. You watch and see what will happen. Where I can see, there will be blessing everywhere. Flood of blessing. We can't catch our breath. And that's what is happening. Yes. We're blessing 2020 cars every Sunday. Yes. Almost every Sunday. Somebody bought a house outright with cash. Flood of blessing. It has never, in the time of this is on assignment. Flood of blessing is on assignment. Yes.
Yeah, man. I hope somebody received that. Hallelujah. Blessing everywhere. Blessing where? Everywhere. What did I just say? Blessing what? Everywhere. Now, quickly, I want to go somewhere as we continue this teaching. Let's go to Luke chapter 5. Luke chapter 5. Luke chapter 5. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, the word is on assignment. Leke to parada. Amen. He that findeth the wife is on assignment. You begin to say that the wife will show up. What are you talking about? You shall be the head and not the... You keep saying it, it's on assignment. You become the head. You are in an establishment, you enter that office, I'll be the head in this office. He said you shall be the head or not. But folks, Christians are shy to pray that prayer. Ah, the head guy, I'm just a temp. Why should I be saved? No, don't see yourself as a temp. See yourself as the manager of the place.
Yes, yes.
Don't see yourself. Our God always called those things that be no. Matter of fact, what excite God? What make God so proud? If you can open your mouth wide, open your mouth wide, you declare things. He said, look. For example, God was calling a man that is 90 years old, the father of many nations. He said, don't worry, a child will come from your loins. The man was laughing. He said, no, I will do it. I will do it. Did it happen or not? You get to your office and say, I'm the head. Yeah. Before you know, a promotion will come. Because that is what others will not say. But you say it. And give God room to walk. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Sometimes you can speak on your womb and say, womb, take twins. Don't say things that God will say, that's my child. David got to a battle and said, what shall be done to the man that killed this Goliath? This boy was 16 or 17 years old. When he went to battle, he said to Goliath, this day, I will bring your head down. Then all of a sudden, I picture David was saying, he said, Goliath, move aside. Then he looked at all the armies of, he said, I will kill all these people and I will feed them to the birds of the air. A whole army of a nation, a boy was saying he will kill them and give them to the bird. What are you talking about? This man knew God. He knew he has to confess it. And as long as he can say it, God will go to work. Hallelujah. The assignment... The world is on assignment. And I'm saying, before the end of this year, in the next 3 months, 3 months is too much. Somebody here, in the next 3 days, in the next 3 days, a miracle will happen to you in the name of Jesus Christ. 3 months is too much for God. Why am I talking? Don't even say, why are you going to tell me 3 months? 3 months, 3 days. 3 days. The world is on assignment. 3 days, you'll be strong as a lion. Any sickness in your body, any pain in your body, any grunt in your body, is pulled to a tree. The tree dried up because the world was on assignment. I command every grunt in your body to dry up in the name of Jesus Christ. Sickness, disease, virus, I command them to dry up in the name of Jesus Christ. You pay attention where we're going tonight. Let's go to the word of God. Luke chapter 5. Luke 5. Thank you, Jesus. Go with me to Luke number 5. Speak the word. Confess it. Thank you, Jesus. The only thing we got as believers is the word. I don't know about you, but the only thing I got is the word of God. And I'm going to use it forever. I'm going to continue to use it. Hallelujah. Amen. I don't be comparing myself. Oh, he got a good job. Okay, you got a good job. I got a good word.
Yes.
Nobody says somebody, oh, he got a good job. They're doing fine. What's my business with that? You got a good job. I got a good word. Hallelujah. So you keep saying that. Don't put yourself down. Don't put a child of God. You cannot put yourself down. I got what will make me the word of God. He uphold all things with the word of his power. Once I have the word, I have everything. Amen? Now look at number 5. Luke 5. Thank you, Jesus. I don't know about you, but before I go back to God, maybe 120 years, I'm going to give to nations.
Yes,
Because if it doesn't happen, God has lied to me. That's why I see myself. He said, ye shall lend to nations. And listen, God did not say nation, nations. But most of us don't see it. With this my 30,000. No. When the Lord turned the captivity. When you read the Bible, I thought, you know, every believer, you should compare scripture with scripture. There was famine in a land. People were dying. And overnight, there was riches in the land. So, for God to flip your life, it doesn't take a decade. It just a night. Sorrow may last a night, but joy cometh in the morning time. There is a day of salvation. Somebody receive salvation today. Receive your deliverance. Receive your healing. In the name of Jesus. Now, Luke chapter 5, I'm going to be reading from King James Version. And it came to pass, please follow me as I follow the Holy Spirit. And it came to pass, let's read together. No, as I'm reading now, don't just look at what I'm reading. You take your own Bible too and read. It's our time to read the Bible. See, you know, can I just teach you again? Don't let devil make you be occupied with your job. Find time to read the Bible. Give God time in your life. That's how he lifts men up. It's the blessing of God that maketh rich. It's not the blessing of your job. Now, it's God that will now put blessing on the job that is occupying you. Is it not wisdom, the one that will put blessing on the job? Is it not blessing to just create time for him? For example, now, let's say I make $100. He said I should give him $10. That means he's also saying, you have 24 hours. Can't you just give me 30 minutes an hour? Can't you just give me an hour, 30 minutes? Okay, you feel that you are too busy, you are too occupied. You drive to your job for 30 minutes. Why can't you just put the Bible up in your car and just listen to Matthew chapter 6 when you are going to work? Or John 1. Why can't you just do that? Instead of that, you are listening to news and junks. God will have mercy. Luke chapter 5. And it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret, and there was two ships standing by the lake. But the fishermen were gone out of them and were washing their nets. Now watch this now. They're washing their nets. And he entered one of the sheep. Now, if there's a, you know, this is interesting because I always ask God, if you want to step into any life, any season, Lord, whatever you are doing, don't do it without me. If you want to step into any life now, Lord, please, Lord, pick me above them. Don't do that to me, Lord. I'm speaking the same thing to you right now. Anywhere you find yourself, you are listening to me, they will not pick any other person above you. It's a prayer you have to be praying. It's a good feeling when you are chosen among many. Hallelujah. I mean, look at Daniel. He was chosen among the Christians. He was chosen. And that's one of the things that God has told me. And that's why I was saying on Sunday that things will return back to normal. Because there's something that God told me to be doing to our children. It's a service that we're going to be having quarterly. As soon as when our children are going to school, you know, what God said I should do is right there. And then I don't even know the assignment God gave me concerning a campus student coming to college. There's something that God asked me to do to them. It's the word of God. These are things that are hidden in the Bible. So I found it. So we're going to be doing it. Amen. So, but let me keep reading because of time. Why did I say that? That God will choose you over others. Yes. It will happen. As you're listening to me right now, they won't want to promote somebody in your office and promote another one. They will promote you. It's you that will promote. I even said, but I just got to that job. It doesn't matter whether you just got to that job. Hallelujah. Now, let's go to, because favor is not fear. Now, he entered to one of the sheep, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land, and sat down and taught the people. Now, listen. Anytime you have opportunity to serve God, don't complain. Anytime God will use your talent, anytime God will use your talent, use the hand he gave you. I mean, I don't know. I mean, if God wants to use the hand he gave you, why do you complain? You should give him your hand and your head. If God wants to use your leg, you should be willing and be thankful that God is. Don't ever complain. Don't ever even have attitude. I'm telling you. Okay, watch this now. A man that have not caught any fish. God, Jesus wanted to use his boat. That is the man that should have attitude. But he never had attitude. These are people that doesn't know Christ yet. But you and I, we know Christ. We're reading the Bible. Peter does not have any Bible to read before then. We have Bible. Anytime God wants to use, it's a privilege and an honor for God to even use you for anything. Because many are called, few are chosen. God has many children. For God to even deem it fit to use you, you will be so glad. Peter said, use my boat. Peter said, use my boat. Hallelujah. And watch what. And let me tell you something. God can use you and dunk you.
No.
What? God is not. Amen. Listen. To everyone, let's say you are going somewhere now, and all of a sudden, somebody just help you and pick your bag and everything like that. Sometimes you feel like just going to your pocket and just, oh, just take this $5. Just take this $10. Thank you so much for just helping me. So our maker will not just leave you, you serve him, and just leave you like that. No. No. He's a rewarder. Rewarder of them that diligently. Now watch this. Now let's keep going. And out of the ship. Now when he has left speaking, after Jesus finished speaking, he was teaching people about goodness, increase, blessing, healing. That's what he was teaching. Amen. So if he's teaching about increase, and he's, how can he now leave a man stranded? Now watch this now. And he said unto Simon, because God will never leave you the same way he met you. You can't be in the Lord 1 year, 2 years, and you remain the same. I mean, you have to check whether you are actually serving him, whether you have received him. No. You can't serve, you can't enter into God and your life remain the same. It will never happen. Everywhere he went, he was doing good. So you can't come into your life. Everyone that Jesus had in contact with them, their life take an upward movement. You can't be associated with God and see shame around you. No. I'm saying capital no. Hallelujah. Now, when he had left speaking, he said to Simon, launch into the deep and let down your net for a what? A drought. A drought. Hallelujah. Now, this drought, if you look at it, let's go. I'll come back to King James, but let's go and look at it in AMPC. A haul. I mean, God, there's somebody here. Before we finish, I'm going to haul. H-A-U-L. I'm going to haul some blessing to come into your family. Watch this now. I don't care what you have now. It doesn't matter. Watch this now. If you go to AMPC, Mark 5, let's go to AMPC, and we come back to King James. Amen. You know we're in Bible study. Let's study the Word of God. We'll come back there. I hope I'm not confusing you because the scripture back and forth. But let's go to AMPC. AMPC means the classic edition of the Amplified Bible. Let's go there. We're going to go to, what verse was I reading before? And nobody remember, right?
Verse 4. When he said to
Simon. Yes, thank you, Pastor. And when he has stopped speaking, he said to Simon, this is AMPC now, Peter, put out into the deep. That means he said, put your boat. You know, they already come out. They were washing their net and all that. You know, they left the deep sea and, you know, and lower your net for a haul. I mean, a haul. What are you talking about? You know what they call a haul? This man had no fish. Listen, Christ known to him at all things. Listen, before you come to him, he already know you are broke. He already know what you are dealing with. So don't come to him that he doesn't know what you are dealing with. The all-knowing God. That's why he's omnipotent, omniscient. He knows the end from the beginning and even the end from the beginning. He's Alpha and he's Omega. He knew. Hallelujah. So, for a whole. I mean, what is this? I mean, somebody that doesn't have anything, God is talking about a whole. He called those things that be not as if they are. For a whole. Now, that's a word. Now, when God said, drop your net for a whole, is left for Peter to agree.
with the word and say the same thing. Now, life and death is in the power of the tongue. Will Peter say, no, that won't happen. That's a lie. I don't believe that. You know, that can't happen. You know, or he's going to speak what Jesus said. Cast your net for a haul. Amen? So now, this is where, like, he said, set before you life and death. Now, sometimes it's not even about Satan. It's about ourselves. Now, watch this now. Peter did, you know, did what every man would do. Now, Peter, you have to understand, Peter is a professional fisherman. Now, a professional fisherman knows that you don't fish in the morning time. Now, they are already in the morning time because you fish in night time, because around 12, 2, because that time, when you throw the net, the fishes, they don't see the net. So you don't go fishing in daytime because the fish will see the net and they will run away. So everything at that time that Jesus said, cast your net. I mean, even if you're going to catch fish during the day, maybe one or two, it's not going to be a haul. Because when the fishes move around, it's in the nighttime. So now, he said, you know, this is not possible. You know, and then Peter was saying, and listen, the word of God, I want you to write this down. Peter doesn't understand. The word of God will work anywhere, anytime, anyhow, anywhere. The word of God doesn't have respect for maybe time or anything like that. It will work at any time. Anybody align himself with the word and speak it, it will work. That's why the Bible said, with men, it's impossible. But not with God. That means God is the word. Nothing can be impossible with the word. So Peter was seeing impossibility. But he got himself, just like when Jesus wanted to give up going to the cross. He was tired. His flesh was taking over him. But he said, no, nevertheless, let your will be done. Amen? So he was able to overcome the flesh. I pray for somebody from today, you will overcome your flesh. Amen. Your flesh will not dictate what will come out of your mouth. Amen. But the word of God in you will dictate to your flesh. Amen. Hallelujah. Now watch this now. But Peter now said, he caught himself quickly. Let's go. If you keep reading, you see, and Simon Peter answered, Master, we toil all night. Jesus knew he was toiling before he said, cast for a haul. Amen? Amen. Now, finish. You see, he has blessed us with everything you need now. God already blessed you with it. You have it. Before the foundation, you see, for every sister, before the foundation of the world, he provided you a husband. He made a husband. For every brother, he made a wife. Before you got married, he made you with children. I'm telling you, before you got married, he already made you, you know, blessed. Now, beloved, I wish above all things, God didn't bring us to America, or if you are born here, to suffer. He brought you so that you can become a blessing. He didn't bring you here to suffer. In fact, when God made Adam and Eve, there was nothing like toiling in the head of God. God put them in the Garden of Eden. Now he said to you and I, he said, look at your father Abraham, Isaiah 51. I called him, blessed him and increased him. And I converted wilderness to Eden. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. I will give you rest. Amen. So there's rest in the word of God. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. So he said, we have toiled all night exhaustingly and caught nothing in our nets. Nothing. How come somebody will go to a big ocean and catch nothing? I believe that even Peter was fighting spiritual battle. Because can you not go to a war and you will not catch with your ship? Not with net, or he didn't go with hook. He went with net and one. They didn't catch one. Hey, hallelujah. But on the ground of your word, hey, hallelujah. On the ground of your word. That is a man that understood the word. On the ground of your word. On the ground of the word of God. On the ground of the word of God, you will make it this year. Amen. It doesn't matter what is happening. On the ground of the word of God, you shall be promoted. On the ground of the word of God, you shall be fruitful. In the name of Jesus Christ. On the ground of the word of God, your desires shall come to pass. Hallelujah. Your head shall be lifted. You will not be the bottom, but you'll be the top. You'll be at the head, not the tail. Never. At the ground of his word. Amen. No sickness can take you. On the ground of the word of God, I declare from your head to the sole of you, your feet, you are made perfect. Every organ in your body, on the ground of the word of God, the word of Yeshua, every organ in your body, you are listening to me right now, I command them to be perfect in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Now, anything not working right in your body, from tonight, if it's going down, I command it to come back up. Because the man of God, Joshua, spoke to a stone, and the stone stood still. Now, every challenge that is taking you down, from today, I command it, turn around by the word, in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, let's keep reading. It caught not in our net, but on the ground of your word, I will lower the net again. And when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish. And as their net were at the point of breaking, they signaled to their partner. That's a haul. Hallelujah. They signaled to their partner in the other boat to come and take hold with them. And they came and filled both the boat so that they began to sink. David said, the Lord is my shepherd. He anointed my head. Oh, my cup runneth over. Now, what's God now? When God wants to meet your need, he doesn't meet it just like that. He takes you to the abundant. He said, I have come that you may have life and have what? In abundance. But before you have abundance in your life, you need to agree with the word of God, and you have to say what the word of God says. I believe by the power, by the leading of the Holy Spirit, when Peter, because Jesus told him, you know, he said, never they are at your word. That means Peter agreed with the word, and you cannot speak the word you don't agree with. You can't speak what you don't agree with. But because Peter agreed, I believe when he was pushing the boat into the deep, Peter was going for, tonight, this morning, I'm going for a haul. I'm going for a haul. At the ground of the world, I'm going for a great catch. At the ground of this world. That was what he was saying. Hallelujah. Out of the abundance of the earth. So Peter kept saying what Jesus said, because he said, at the ground of your world. That means he agreed. Amen. Most of us, we are struggling because we don't agree. And because you don't agree, it's difficult for you to say it out. If you can align yourself, oh my God, with the word of God, you'll find that those need, just like God, that the Lord that meet the need of Peter, will meet your own need too in Jesus' mighty name. Now, watch this now. But when Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knee and said, depart from me, for I am a sinful man. What happened? He was astonished. Peter was astonished. He was astonished. He was like, God, what is this? I didn't get one. Now, both their boats were filled and sinking. Now, going back to Isaiah 51, Isaiah 55, 11, the word of God is predictable. Jesus, now, in the same scripture, when Jesus saw the boat filled up, Jesus was not astonished. If you go back to King James, you'll see there, Jesus was not astonished. Why is it that Peter was astonished and Jesus was not astonished? Jesus was not astonished because he knew the word of God is predictable. Hallelujah. He knew that the word of God is on assignment and it will not remain void. What did the word of God say? He said, cast your net for a haul. It must happen. It must happen because Peter agreed. If Peter has not agreed that day, he will go home broke. He will go back the same. You know why we remain the same and things are not changing in our life? It's because we refuse to say what God said we should say. And sometimes we say it and we don't say it enough. Peter kept saying, pushing it there and going for a haul. And that's what happened. Tonight, as your pastor, I'm going for a haul of blessing. Haul of blessing. I'm pulling into your life. Receive it in the name of Jesus Christ. The word of God is on assignment. You got to believe it. You have to believe it. You have to agree with it. Nevertheless, let it be done to me according to your word. You speak it and you shall what? Have it. Now, quickly, I want to go somewhere. Holy Spirit helping me tonight. If you go to Mark 11. Mark 11. Thank you, Jesus. Mark 11, 13 to 14. Let's go there quickly. Mark 11. Mark 11. Thank you, Jesus. Mark 11, we're going to go to verse 13. verse 13. Jesus showed us something here. Thank you, Jesus. And seeing a fig tree afar of having what? Leaves, it came, if happily it might find anything thereon. And when it came to eat, it found nothing but leaves. But the time of fig tree was not. And Jesus answered and said unto it. Now Jesus spoke to the tree. No man. And now you have to know that everything in this world was formed by the word. Hallelujah. And now he said, he uphold all things. Hebrew 1:3, that means he uphold all things by the word of his power. You know, so that means you can speak to anything in this world, both animate and inanimate. Amen. No man eat fruit of this thereafter forever. And the disciple had it. Now listen, the disciple had it. Jesus did not think it. Confession, you shall have whatsoever you say. Don't think it, say. Positive thinking is enough. Jesus, listen. When they were in the boat, the book of Mark 4, and water was coming into the boat, there was storm. Jesus is the best positive thinker you can ever think of in this world. But if Jesus said he was a positive thinker and never opened his mouth, the water will wipe him away, I'm telling you. What did he do? He spoke. Peace be still. Hallelujah. You have to speak. You have to speak. They're sending your children home that is not doing well in school. You are beating the child. You don't beat the child. You go on your knee and speak. You speak wisdom to his head. Hallelujah. Yes, now. And Jesus answered and said unto, if no man eat fruit. And these disciples, they had it. And they came to Jerusalem. They had what he said. So, don't. If I say, oh, but I'm well. Maybe you are walking, you just sneeze. Say, no, I'm well in Jesus' name. Then some people, you are looking around, who is hearing you? You don't need to look around. Let them hear. They must hear it and let them laugh. Now, when they now went, and Jesus went to do other business, and when they were returning, if you go to number 20, and in the morning, as they passed by, they saw the fig tree dried off from the roots. Watch this now. And Peter, the same Peter, calling to remembrance, said unto him, because they had him. Amen. That's why when you're in church, if I speak the word of God in the service and you say amen, it must appear in your life, because the word of God is on assignment. To as many as receive it in the church, there'll be performance. So said unto him, Master, behold the fig tree, just like this morning, surprises. God will surprise you with a miracle job. I'm telling you, you watch out. Whatever you need before the end of this month, the surprise will show up in Jesus' mighty name. And Peter, calling to remember, said unto him, Master, behold the fig tree which thou caused is withered away. And Jesus answered. Jesus was not astonished. Peter was astonished. Peter was surprised that, but if you are a child of God, you should expect what you say to come to pass, because Isaiah 51, 55, 11 say, the word is on assignment, it will not return void, it will accomplish what he said, he sent it for, and in that matter, it will prosper. So Jesus was not astonished, but they were astonished that, what happened? The future, Jesus said, have the God kind of faith. So the God kind of faith is the faith that speaks. Faith-filled word. So I commend you to this word tonight. From tonight, begin to speak faith-filled word, and your life will never remain the same. I pray for you tonight that you will never be like Job. Job allowed the devil to fire a word into him. And what the devil fired into Job, Job sat there meditating on it. Job was a man that feared God and shunned evil. All of a sudden, devil introduced into his head that he's going to lose all his money, he's going to lose his children. Then Satan, instead of Job to resist the devil He started meditating on it, and all of a sudden, what he meditated upon, Job started saying it. You know, if you go to Job, let's go to Job 3:25. He started saying it. And you know, sometimes people say, what happened to Job? It was God tempting him. God does not tempt with evil. Understand this fact. God does not do evil. The problem of Job started with his thoughts. As a man thinketh, so he is. Job started, he bought the idea of the devil. The Bible talks about, he said, whatsoever is true, losing whatever you have. God does not give and take away. If you have been saying that and you stop tonight, God does not give and take away. I don't serve a God that give me something and take it away. As long as I'm living right, I have more common sense to live holy. You know, I can't live holy by my power, but at least I'm moving towards his, you know, the path that he says I should move towards. So God will not give me something and take it away. Don't you know you'll be mean to that father? How can a father give you something and take it away? Do you want to serve such a God? No. God is not evil. So he does not tempt nobody with evil. So the problem of Job was not God. It was Job. Every man is tempted when he's drawn by his own desire. So Job sat, he bought the idea of the devil. So when the devil tried to shoot anything to you that does not align with the word of God, wisdom demands that you resist it. Don't let it stay in your spirit. Amen? Now, Job 3. Just give me 5 minutes and I'll be running up. Job 3. Look, I just needed to get this. Job. Thank you, Jesus. Job 3. And then we look at what verse should I give you now? Can we go to, let's see, 24? Praise the Lord. Okay, because of time, let me just, you know, Job said, the things which I greatly fear has come upon me. So it was fear. And the Bible said, we should not speak fear. Fear brings torment. Fear brings what? Torment. Now, we're not supposed to meditate on anything that is not of God. Anything that wants to go against the knowledge of God. You bring it out to subjection. Job should have been saying, no, I'm not going to lose my children. I'm not going to lose my house. I'm not going to lose my possession. No. God has given to me. And whatever the Lord has done, it shall be forever. Nothing can be taken from me. The Lord has done it. It is forever. His name will be glorified. But Job was thinking and saying what the devil wanted him to say. What the devil wants to do is to get your heart. And after getting your, get your mouth. Don't allow the devil to get your mouth and your heart. No. Hallelujah. So now, after that, when Job now saw the problem that he went through, now finally, I want us to go to Job chapter 6. We're going to read from 23 to 25. If I have time, maybe the last Sunday of this moment I'm teaching more, I will let you know about this Job. Job was thinking about that problem so much that he said, when he's eating, he will just be sighing. He said, let me, I think I need to say this to you. Don't let me write this, you know. Job 3, if you look at from 25, New King James Bible, he said, for all the things I greatly fear has come upon me, and what I dreaded. Now, how can a Christian dread thing? He said, the things that I dreaded has happened to me. I am not at ease. Job was not at ease. A Christian must be at ease. His peace. He has given us his peace. Don't let any situation take your peace. He said, I am not at peace, nor am I quiet. I have no rest. Why should he not rest? The Bible says, rest in the Lord, and he will give you the desire of your heart. But Job was telling himself, he has no rest. For trouble, he said, he has no rest, but trouble came. That's what he was saying. And that's why, he said, when he's eating, you know, he's groaning and sighing. How can you be eating and you are groaning and sighing? He allowed a man that was so blessed. How can you get yourself to the point that devil get him to the point that he will be sighing? He's groaning.
You know, there's some people, when you stand around them, you'll just be yelling, what is going on? Why are you sounding like that? As a Christian, you don't need to sound like that. Then finally, Job came to his senses. Job number 6, and then we'll round up. Job 6, quickly. Job 6. God does not give and take away. Please, I know there's a song like that, God give and take away. No, no, no. If you like that song, when you get to that thing, don't sound it. Don't say that part. God does not give and take away. No. Whatsoever the Lord doeth, it shall be forever. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm serving a God that wants me to have the best. He won't give me the best and take it away. Are we ready? Let's go to Job. I want King James. Pastor, you got it? My phone is just seizing here. Job 6, we're reading from 23, please. 23 to 25, New King James Version.
New King James.
Yes.
23 to...
Job 6, please. Just please be out with us. Yes. Oh, Pastor, don't worry, I got it. 23, I'll read from here. Now, Job, you know, after a while, he said, oh, deliver me from the enemy's hand. Or deliver me from the enemy's hand. Or redeem me from the hand of the oppressor. He said, now, teach me. Watch this now. Teach me, and I will hold my tongue. Cause me to understand where I have made error, where I went wrong. And what was the problem with Job? It was below his nose. His problem was below his nose. That means his mouth. Hallelujah. How forcible are right words? But what does your argument prove? Do you intend to rebuke my words? Hallelujah. So the problem of Job started with his mouth. From this night, I pray in the name of Jesus that somebody, you will put God on your mouth. You will put, you will be able to bridle your tongue. You will not say it. Just mute. Sometimes it's good to mute. When you get angry and you want to say what you're not supposed to say, you just mute. I think it's better. Because you cannot say before the angel is an error. Once you say it, it is done. So don't say what God did not say. I pray that the Lord will bless you. That's what we got for tonight. I believe next week I'll continue from here. And I believe the Lord, mighty God, will bless you. And you have listened to this message tonight. If you have any question, you know, you can go to the website of the church. You can shoot us an email. Definitely, we will take care of the question. But, you know, one thing about believer is that don't assume that you know it. As I'm teaching right now, because Bible study, and you feel that, I don't really get what Pastor is saying there. You know, you can just shoot, and I will take time to explain to you one-on-one. I will explain it to you, or I can explain it the next Bible study. Praise the name of the Lord, because also understand it. Don't assume that you know it. You must know it. Assumption will not take you anywhere as a believer. You must have a command of the Word of God. And once you have a command of anything, you become an eye flyer. That shall be your portion in Jesus' mighty name. At this time, we're going to be collecting our offerings, so please, you can go to the church platform, the website, to give your offering. That's RCCG. I believe, I will tell the media anytime we're doing Bible study, they can also put it on the platform so that you can see it. You can give your offering, you know. Don't say we are not in church, we're in church. You have to give your offering. You have to pay your tithe, you know, because, I mean, as a true child of God, it's our covenant obligation. Say we should not come before Him empty-handed. So give your offering. So, Father, we just thank you for your word tonight. And, Lord, as your children, I've heard your word. Faith come by hearing and by the hearing of the word of God. The grace to do all that we have been taught tonight. Lord, let that grace be released. Father, help us with our mouth. Let our mouth, our heart, and our mouth align with your word. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we thank you. And as we confess your word, we believe the purpose of your word in our life will come to pass in the name of Jesus. Your word will never be useless in our life, but it will accomplish that which you have sent it to do in our life. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we thank you for it, and we give you all the glory. Lord, behold our offering as we give to you tonight. Father,
According to your word, you say you will bless us and you will open the windows of heaven and flood our lives with your blessing. Lord, do that for us and let your name be glorified. Thank you, Master Jesus. In Jesus' name, we are prayed. And please, as you give your friend, don't forget Thursday. We're meeting again Thursday on Zoom. And we're still believing if we can go on also on YouTube, but we'll let you know. But definitely we'll be on Zoom on Thursday for our prayer meeting by 7 p.m. Be there. Men ought to pray and not faint. And as you do that, as a matter of fact, where we're going next month, September, I'm amazed with the theme of next month. Hallelujah. Don't let me get ahead of myself. But please, men ought to pray, and he shall be well with you in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you so much for being a part of this service tonight. We'll look forward to seeing you on Thursday. And if I may announce to you, very soon we are going to be having a powerful presence on social media. God is working out some things. Hallelujah. God is building some things that, you know, this church will never remain the same. Amen. So that we can have a solid, you know, presence on our social media platform. God is working out things. Amen. We'll let you know what God is trying to do. Our Facebook, our Twitter account. So now if you're watching us today, we want you to like our YouTube video. We want you to subscribe to our YouTube. Follow us on Twitter, you know, on our Instagram page. Please follow us, and it shall be well with you as you do that in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you so much for being a part of Sabbath. We love you. And we'll be looking forward to seeing you on Sunday in the service. Amen. Call me that you're coming to church. Some of you have not been to church for 5 months. Are you comfortable? Amen. Find a way to come to church. If your husband has been coming to church, tell your husband to, you stay home today. Let me go to church one Sunday too. Amen. You stay with the children. But there's somebody that cannot do that. She's laughing right now. But Humphrey is not going to stay home because I need him in the church. Amen. God is good. Let's share the grace in fellowship. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Surely his goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. Thank you so much, everybody. We love you. Thank you. Have a good night. Thank you. See you on Thursday. Thank you. Bye. Lord, you are so good.